Hello, Mary, me, everybody. It's Michele Marie. It's only Lumi Anne Finistra, and we're tired today. Setting up for the shot. Lumi and Mike Vitalle today. We're going to want to talk about the afterlife. There's different views on the afterlife, but let's start with what we have for latest news. Several medical doctors in Canada doing medical research on life after death, involving four comatose patients that were on life support, three of which, when their life support were terminated, expired, as you would expect. The fourth patient, after the heart stopped beating for 10 minutes, reached a brain wave of a delta wave, which is a really deep wave. It affects the brain. The doctors immediately assumed that, given the fact that there was no blood flowing to the brain at that point, that the brain was interacting with an outside force in a delta wave pattern. I described the situation, Michele, as almost like uploading firmware to the cloud, or returning your data to the cloud. And Cat, what the heck are you doing with those claws? He wants attention. Again. Alright, so feed him then. And then we can get this started. I'm not normally grouchy, but after you die?
Generally speaking, most people go to the hospital. First, so that they can make sure that if there's any chance of saving them, that they can be saved before they pass away.
All I know is, like I said, there's been a lot of hypotheses of what happens to you after you die. And some people have described the near-death experience, NDE, so they describe the tunnel. And even though most of the near-death experiences have been positive, there have been some near-death experiences where the experience after entering the tunnel was anything but positive. In other words, they saw the bowels of hell.
Bowels of hell.
So the question is what is the real story? Is it upon the moment you expire that your course is already plotted because of your life actions on this earth and causing you to either go through to the left door towards hell and purgatorium, or is it that you have a chance prior to a death, such as a deathbed confession, to change the path of where you're going to go? And when is it too late to change your path that you go? That's a question a lot of people ask about that.
The path? What do you mean, before or after?
All right, in other words, if you're laying in your bed, either at home among loved ones or in a hospital room somewhere, obviously, at this point, you're still somewhat conscious. And you start to see the tunnel as your body slowly slips away, your mind slips away. Is there any way that one at that moment can change their destiny if they're going to go to heaven, purgatory, or hell?
Well, I mean, while we're still here, we have the choice.
Well, we still have some physical control over our corporal body.
Yeah. Why wouldn't you?
Well, the question is there so many people in this world have been for the last, since the 60s especially, that have said that there is no heaven, there is no hell. There is no purgatory. There's no nothing after you die. You just draw your last breath and you're meat. Whereas Canadian researchers seem to confirm that that's not so simple. So the question is when we die, are we meat only? Or has does our operating system / firmware / soul return to the other side? And then the body still becomes meat? Or what?
I think that even if we pass away, there's still a chance for us to be who we are. I think the medical field needs to develop a way of being able to bring people back healthily back to who they are. I don't think that very many, I just feel like there is more to it. It's not just a meat thing.
I think I almost like to see death as like when you go like going on a boat, you know, like crossing the river Styx. In other words, you pay the ferryman, you get on your boat, that's when you croak, right? But then you've already got your fare paid, and he takes you through across the river Styx. So your soul takes the journey, but your meat bag don't. If that makes any sense to anybody. In other words, your soul is created by God and is perfect. Your soul is who you are, your essence, whereas your physical carny flesh is just a vehicle that moves you along this earth. If that makes any sense. Sometimes it's really hard because we try to come up with topics and sometimes it makes it really hard to come up with good ones. I know one of my friends was talking about her husband she had been married to for a few years died in a car accident. And I'm not going to give names, but for those of you who did see the Thursday night broadcast, she was interviewed on our program. And one of the things is that she talked about was if she wanted to know if he was in a better place. And the answer is, of course, he's in a better place.
You also have to try to encourage the spirit to be in that place. Or, see, like, anybody's final moments is not really anybody else's. The people who deserve to be with who they deserve to be with, where they deserve to be, is generally how it's looked at throughout history, you know? Like, if a person was a good person, they're going to a better place. They deserve to be in a better place.
Right. I mean, this earth is a living classroom. This is where we learn skills that we can take back with us to the other side. Hmm. The bodies that we have here on earth, you could say, are like our school uniforms. They were lent to us in the form of the earth by the Almighty God. They're not permanent. So if you think that all the aches and pains and ailments that you have on earth is going to follow you to the other side, it's not the case. In your home with God, you are made perfect. You are free of blemish. But if the soul gets stained, then you have to go through a period of purgatorium to purge those imperfections from your soul. In the Catholic Church, we have what we call All Souls Day, which is better known as Samhain or Halloween. It's where we can pray for all the souls that have gone before us to help them to reach a state of perfection so they can enter into the other side, the kingdom. But there's also, unfortunately, a series of people who, because of their own faults and their deeds and what they've done and what they have failed to do, never get upgraded to the other side. But they don't go to hell, but they just don't progress. Some of them refuse to even go through the tunnel, and they become ghosts and spirits. Some of them is because, especially in some religions, have said it's because you have sinned, you and fallen short of glory of God, you are not eligible to receive the God, so don't even bother going. And those people just basically say, well, I'm not good enough, even when they die, and they stay here as ghosts and spirits. Whereas there are some that stay here because they feel that they have an obligation to fulfill. Those are a little different situation. Those people have chosen to stay here because they feel they have to complete an obligation. But it's the first group that is a real tragedy, because they think that Almighty Father, Mother, God are going to basically, just because you walk through the tunnel means that you're going to go walking through the tunnel to hell. That's not necessarily the case. That's the thing that I think a lot of evangelicals especially have been trying to push, that they believe in something called predestination. Predestination says that God already has determined if you're going to go to heaven or hell even before you come here. Well, I don't think that's the case. We know that Almighty Yahweh and Mother Asna don't want us to go to hell because they love us. But I think that the concepts that some of the churches have taught have actually caused more harm among the ranks than just being honest and saying is we have no idea if you're going to go to heaven or hell. We don't know what person is going to go to heaven or hell. But you always have the opportunity to go to heaven by doing the right thing and try to straighten out your life and try to live a good life. What's your opinion?
Try to live a good life. Try as hard as you can.
And of course, we know that God knows that if there's reasons why you cannot reach the higher level of your life, it doesn't necessarily mean it's your own fault. There's some people, because they take on a life chart responsibility, it's just too great, and they can't reach that situation. So maybe we should ask this question. What, for the evangelicals out there, the Bible belters, you know, the ones I'm talking about, you know these people, so why? Is how can we explain that some of their teachings that they have been taught is not correct without angering the person?
I'm not sure.
I mean,
I guess subject matter that you would imagine would be common. Like,
I mean, like, for example, take what John Calvin said. He said he believes in predestination. He created the Calvinistic church. We know that in America it's a congregational church. He teaches predestination. He says that you already determined if you're going to go to heaven or hell. You don't know about it, but God does. And Michele and I said this, wait a minute, what if you've always done a good job to admire God and to serve God? Do those people have the right to go to hell because they're doing what God wants them to do? And the few pastors me and Michele talked to was like, huh, that's a great question. That's not a good answer if you believe in predestination. It's like saying, it's like, oh, I'm sorry, you know what? It's like, if you believe that you're going to go to heaven because you're doing what God's will, and then all of a sudden you go to hell, you know, that's not a good answer to say is, we don't know where you're going to go. You know, people, and then what's the incentive for people to try to do the best they can? If all you're going to say to them is that God is going to choose to send you to hell because you ate meat on Friday during Lent. You know, or was God's going to send you to hell because you said the F-bomb a few times on the video? Or God's going to send you to hell because you aborted your baby? That's the question is predestination, is what is the real story? I have no idea.
To predestination? I don't know if there is such a thing as predestination. But then again, You know, we don't
choose... John Calvin thought there was.
We don't choose who we're born from. We don't choose where we're born. And we don't really choose what we do or where we go up to a certain point. You know what I mean?
Yeah, but according to John Calvin, he says predestination is already preordained by God. You're going to go either heaven or hell, and you have no control over it.
Some people may be predestined. Some. For whatever reason, we don't know.
Okay. Well, look, one other thing I also would like to focus on is something about once we arrive on the other side. Because this is more or less what the lady was asking me about. When we die, okay, and we enter the gateway, the tunnel, the bridge, usually among children's a bridge. Among adults, it looks like something like the Boston Big Dig tunnels. I hope me and Michelle get to go across the bridge. Oh, that'd be nice instead of being a big tunnel, but I don't know what's going to happen. I don't know either, but... Okay, once we get to the other side, there's like an intake stage where you kind of get reacquainted with the other side. Because after all, when you are on this earth, your knowledge of the other side is pretty scant. It's because all that parts of your background is wiped out. So you can start with what little you need to know for this earth. And the thing is that some people are always saying this is, well, we're not going to go to heaven, we're not going to go to hell. There's no afterlife, there's no angels, there's no nothing. So in other words, when we go to the other side, we go through receiving, they're going to go ahead and they're going to introduce you to your, case, you know, your spirit guide and look at your life chart, and then they say, okay, God, now we're going to go ahead and send you to the next life. Whoop, just like that. That's more what happens on the, that's what happens when you go through the left door, not through the right door. Yeah, the left door is where you don't have any control. You have no will when you go through the left door. That is when you become, for all intents and purposes, it's just like being a military conscript. You know, you're given walking orders by the dark entities and saying, you're going to go back to New York City in 2030 and you're going to be a prostitute. And that's your choice. And no, it's not your choice. That is your order, soldier. So shut up, stand up, and get ready to go back to Earth in 2030. That doesn't sound too nice. No, it's not. It's not. I don't think I'd want to have somebody telling me that I have no right to decide where I'm going to go. Whereas on the other side, with Mother and Father God, is you do have that right to say as nicely as, well, my life chart, I'd like to take a few, take some time off to recuperate from my last life. And they allow you to do that. So, why don't we discuss briefly something we don't hear much about. Let's talk about what happens on the other side. What kind of activities do you do on the other side?
I don't know. I'm not on the other side. Why would I have be on the other side and be doing something and know what to do? How would I be able to tell you?
Well, certainly you're not going to be sitting in front of a microphone talking about it.
So why would you ask me the question?
Well, I'm asking you because I want to get your opinion on it.
My opinion on what I think happens on the other side? I don't think we can really know until we get there.
Well, I have some information from a few people that have been there, such as Sylvia Brown, and she said that the other side is a place of great joy, great happiness. Obviously, as it says in the scriptures, there's no sadness, there's no pain, there's no suffering. The weather is always a balmy, about 21 degrees Celsius. It doesn't rain. It doesn't snow, in a sense. The snow, if it is snow, it's cold, it's warm snow. Spare me. Warm snow. That'd be like eating warm ice cream. That doesn't melt, though. I know, but still. What if you like cold snow? Then that's not heaven. No, that would kind of suck. Yeah. And everybody has to do the things that they love on the other side. I mean, like, for example, if you like gardening, you garden. If you like cooking, you can cook. If you like playing music, you can play music. If you like teaching, you can teach. It's a place where all the great buildings of throughout history have existed throughout time, and they're still there, such as the copy of the Library of Alexandria. There's no corruption. There's no bribery. There's no stealing. There's no anything bad. Unless you have to one thing, you can't eat on the other side. Yes, you can. So if you love cheeseburgers, for example, you can eat all the cheeseburgers you want and you won't gain a pound. I don't get that part.
I do.
I mean, it's like, are you eating spiritual cheeseburgers? In other words, are you eating simulated meat that really doesn't exist?
I wouldn't go there. I don't think you want to find out the answer.
Well, I kind of would like to know, because if you if you could eat all you want, it'd be the ultimate Atkins diet. You would never have to worry about going, gee, oh, I have to worry about eating or playing Deal a Meal with the Richard Simmons cards. And then, oh, screw it. I got stuck with another grapefruit. Oh, you're killing me. No, but seriously, I don't really know much about the other side, other than what I know is just that there's a council, there's a places that we can go on the other side where they help inspire people on Earth to come up with new ideas and concepts, and there's a place that they can actually share information. There's a people on the other side, most of them can bilocate. Our cats, our dogs, our pets will be there on the other side. Now remember, your pets are, for all intents and purposes, are perfect. They don't have to go back to this earth repeatedly year after or life after life to make themselves perfect in the eyes of God, because they already are perfect. That's why your pets don't have to worry about challenges. They've already been guaranteed, because they are free of sin, that they will be on the other side after the single incarnation. That's true, but I wonder if the cat wants to come back again. I don't think they can, because they're not... I don't know how that works. I don't know what works with pets either. I'll have to ask more detail. But for now, let's talk about something. Talk about infirmities. You have been trying to get your legs better. Yes, I have. And I think I'm making some progress. Unfortunately, when I set the camera up in order to get Mike in the frame, I fell backwards and landed on my bum on top of the little white-black table behind the camera. And so, fortunately, I did not land on those candlesticks. Yeah, that would really be not so nice if those glass things went in your ass. Ow! Yes, they would have really... Pardon my French, really been a pain in the bum. Yes, okay. So anyway, back to your legs. Well, my legs are, like I mentioned this morning in the vlog, they're getting stronger. But they're, it's a challenge. Because for over 2 years, I always say it's 2.5. It's actually been about 2 years. 2 years ago, what started out as a hairline fracture from 5 years ago, all of a sudden, something got really wrenched out really bad. And so when I was even living at the Roadway Inn, my hip would start to hurt, and I wouldn't be able to go very far. And it was excruciatingly painful. And so my legs would just lock up because of the pain. So they were hurt so bad that I didn't want to get out of bed at all. So I basically laid in bed almost as much as 20 hours a day. Ouch. And so during that, hoping that my legs were going to get re-strengthened. Of course, I knew that wasn't necessarily the case. And it wasn't. The legs actually got weaker. And because the muscles were not untwisting until a friend of mine who is a home healthcare specialist told me what I had to do to straighten out the situation. So I had started doing the exercises that you suggested and coming up with a few of my own to help pull those muscles taut. And that resulted in a lot of nasty language. Trust me, you could hear, you could almost feel the muscle flop around in my leg. And so then finally, after I was, all the muscles were untwisted, except for one little tiny muscle group, which is still kind of twisted, not as bad. My legs were all swollen up. They were getting all black and blue. And Dory was like, "Oh my God, this is terrible looking," she said. "You really need to see a specialist." I'm like, "Yeah, who's going to pay for it?" See, most people don't realize that, you know, I didn't have the kind of money that they needed to see a specialist. Right. Okay. So what I did was I asked Mother and Father God. I said, "Hey, you know, guys, am I doing the right thing?" Mom says, "Oh, yeah, you're doing the right thing. But now you got to walk alone around a little more. You got to try to be more active." You know, yes, you should take it easy too, but you should try to start moving around more. And even if it hurts, you know, build your strength up. So walk around when you can, and then when you get tired, just sit down, rest for a little bit. And then when the fatigue goes away, then you can go ahead and exercise some more, and then walk around some more, and that's what I've been doing. Do you think that this actions on your body is possibly caused by, say, your failures, or do you think this is something that is part of your life chart, a challenge that you have to overcome? And I think Mike can understand this to some extent. I think it's a life challenge I have to overcome. And everybody has challenges in their lives that are part of our enrichment process of education, that where we need to overcome certain difficulties to be more knowledgeable and seeing what we're good at or what we're not good at. I'm sure, Mike, you probably have similar things in your own life. Challenges that you need to overcome.
Yeah, maybe a few.
You say maybe a few? Why, you sure you don't have any? Sounds like you're saying you're not sure.
I don't know. I'm just sitting here making a video with you, buddy.
Yeah. Well, I think to all the audience that are watching this, is that I think this table likes to move around on us. When are you gonna screw this to the floor? What? Huh? Seriously? If you screwed it to the floor, it wouldn't whoop like that. Yeah, but you screw it to the floor, then you're gonna have cleats in the floor. Yeah. Okay, so. Do you think, so you think that your life now is better, in your own opinion, where it's been a couple of years ago, or you say you're finally starting to cope with all the issues and all the challenges that were thrust upon you about 2 years ago? I would say...
Are you okay, Michele?
Hmm?
You okay?
I'm just thinking. I would say, for the most part, that maybe I'm doing better now because I'm beginning to cope with the things in my life that I wasn't able to fully address 2.5, 3 years ago. When I lost the Section 8 in 2015, in November, that resulted in a lot of challenges to come to grips with the fact that there no longer was any entitlements to help me keep the rent paid. And so I think that made a challenge for me to have to come up with other ways to keep things like this YouTube channels I do and you do running. Yeah. So, Mike, what do you think? Do you think your experiences in your life has made your life stronger?
I have no idea.
I mean, you've been going through challenges like everybody else does for years.
Doesn't appear to have.
Do you seem to be doing easier now, or does it seem like they're still impossible?
I don't know. It depends on who's in the way.
What do you mean by who's in the way?
I mean, if I'm trying to get a job, sometimes people tell them not to give me a job for whatever reason they think. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Kind of really sucks. Especially when you have no money or anything, you know?
Well, you know, as far as the jobs go, it's like, try having something that's like a physical infirmity that can see, like legal blindness. And Michelle's tried to find jobs, and she finally just gave up because it was like, oh, no one's going to hire me, so fuck it, I have to create my own jobs. That's what these channels are for. If no one donates anyway. So I don't know, is it better to be told that you can't do the job and not have already invested a lot of money and time and stuff in to make it happen? Or is it better to go ahead and buy all the equipment, buy all the microphones, buy all the lights, buy all the cameras, and then be told that no one will want to make a donation to your channel to help support you?
I think that would be a difficult challenge to have. Say, for example, this is the only job you really have.
At this time, I used to be a dishwasher at restaurants.
You know what I mean? So this basically helps put the money in your pocket or put the food
supposed
on the
to,
table
but no one's really donated anything for the past 5 years. Mm-hmm. Michelle used to get donations from somebody long ago when she started out from Canada. He used to donate like $100 every few months. And with that money, Michelle was able to work in a studio and make things better. But then that money stopped coming. And that created all kinds of sadness for Michelle because with no money coming in, it was like, okay. She's been trying to find ways to bring more money in, but it's just not. She doesn't know what the audience wants. She tried live streams, and everybody starts calling, have no respect for Michelle's efforts, and start, you know, acting like really bad people on the phone. And some of them seem to have a strong desire to watch a lot of Howard Stern, like TV. You know, Howard Stern is the guy, and Michelle explains to the audience nicely, we are not Howard Stern. We're not going to act like Howard Stern. We are a professional medium. This is a channel that is designed and operated to be much better than Howard Stern. And you know who Howard Stern is, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yes?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, I guess you don't know.
No, I know who Howard Stern is.
Howard Stern, Michelle will tell you, is a shock jock.
Shock jock? What's a shock jock?
He says bad things, does bad things, just to increase his ratings. His language is so nasty that he got thrown off several AM radio stations because of his language. The Federal Communications Commission will not even allow him to be on a publicly broadcasted AM or FM radio station because of his potty mouth.
It's not good.
This program sucks anyway. Yeah, okay. But when we get back to the main topic Lumi is trying to talk about is... I think, back to the main topic. Okay, now here we are. It's 2017. Michele has, I feel, professionally has achieved a lot of her life goals that she had agreed on when she came here from the other side. But I think that she still has a few things left. What cat? Let's bring him up here. Oh, right up. Oh. Why are your feet wet, cat? No, fire is not his friend. Nope, not with that fur. Nope. All right, so you're saying is that you think I've achieved a lot of things, but you think that I still have ways to go. I think you have done pretty good over your lifetime. I think you still have some ways to go before you reach that perfect state. Okay. So, hold on, cat. What are you doing? I'm just looking at this pen here. It's one of Dory's pens for decorating pens, green tip ballpoint.
Hey, do you think there'll ever be a zombie apocalypse? Do you think there'll ever be a zombie apocalypse?
That depends on what you mean by a zombie apocalypse.
You know, like the dead come to life and start eating people?
No, not like that. I mean, you're talking about the dead spiritually, not necessarily eating people, but killing them. yeah, we already see that at Trump rallies.
That's like dry humor.
No, it's like all those leftists, they're sitting there all the time, and they're like...
Tasteless.
They're talking about how all the stuff that Donald Trump's trying to do for the
government... I just gave your show better ratings.
No, it's just a sad thing. It's like you're watching those protesters at those Trump rallies. It's like watching the zombies you're talking about. They're like, they're so misinformed that they think...
Oh, boy.
That they go out there and say, Trump's a racist, Trump's a this, Trump's that. And then you really ask them why they say that, and they can't tell you because they can't give you a straight answer. It's like, who the hell told you all this shit, you know? I don't know. That's what I was told by somebody else. Why don't you research it yourself? I don't have time. You don't have time to research it, but you have time to spread possibly false truths around. Oh, that's really nice of you. Exactly. Yeah, that's just the problem right there. Is when you got those people saying that stuff and that they can't even prove why they're saying that, if it's true or false, because they don't know. So if you're talking about those kind of leftists being the zombies of the future, yeah, I think those are the kind of zombie apocalypse we don't need. Is ignorant people who don't know the truth and don't want to take the time to actually research the truth. But as far as people coming out of the ground and searching for brains like you see in zombie movies, I don't think that's going to quite happen.
Hey, you never know.
But then again, you saw those people that were using those illegal thing called bath salts, and they were kind of doing that. Like the one guy in Miami that chomped on the other guy under the influence of bath salts. And why do they call them bath salts anyway? You don't put them in your bath water.
Yeah, you're supposed to. You're actually supposed to put them in the bath. They're actually for drawing a bath.
What does it do in the bath?
It's supposed to make the bath soothing. You know, like a lady would...
Then why are people eating it?
Put the soap in... They had specific, like, Avon medicated bath salts so that people who are sore, whatever.
Okay, so you're saying it's the real bath salts. They're not something like K2. It was made in some lab and just called bath, so it's just a keyword. Okay. I'll take your word for it.
K2 was actually supposed to be meant to be a potpourri. You aren't supposed to smoke it. You're supposed to burn it in a dish.
And then why were people smoking it then?
Because somebody had tried to smoke it and got messed up on it and decided to say, hey, why don't you guys try buying the K2 and smoking that?
But it's... Now, by the way, speaking of drugs, what about now that Massachusetts has legalized marijuana? But unfortunately, the legalized sales and division hasn't yet been regulated, has not been created. So if you want, even if it's legal to smoke marijuana in Massachusetts, you still got to buy it from the neighborhood junkie. The question is are those neighborhood junkies going to go through and legally become legalized sellers of marijuana when the state of the Massachusetts Commission on Marijuana, whatever they're going to call it, is going to legalize it? Are they going to go for the licenses to become legalized sellers? What do you think? Me? Yeah, you. If the state of Massachusetts allowed the junkies to go through the proper permit procedures, since it's, they might say, yeah, sure, why not? So what if I got to pay sales tax and stuff on the stuff in the state of Massachusetts whenever, you know, but it means I can finally show to somebody that I can make a gainful living out doing something that I love doing. And if it is something that for a long time was never legal, now it's legal, so now I can go ahead and sell it legally. Very touchy topic. VTT! Very touchy topic. Yeah. But also the state of Illinois also wants to legalize medicinal marijuana as well. And I think they want to go for the medicinal, but yeah, I think the RR for legalization of recreational is also considered in some states. I know Arizona and Arkansas does have legalized medicinal marijuana use. But now everybody keeps wondering, what is Jeff Sessions going to do? The Attorney General Jeff Sessions, is he going to continue to allow the states to determine their own within-state borders policies, or is he going to demand that all states must adhere to the federal drug enforcement agency rules, saying that marijuana is a Schedule I drug and should not be legally available with or without a prescription? Well, I know that. I know that there's a woman in Hawaii, which is a Republican Democrat, and there is a Republican that also wants to change this classification of marijuana from a Schedule 1 to a Schedule 2, maybe even a Schedule 3.
What is that?
Well, if it's a Schedule 2, that means that you can get it with a prescription. If it's a Schedule 3, you can get it if you are over 21 years of age. In that case, you could go to, say,
a dispensary.
A dispensary, which you'd be able to go to now. But let's say your dispensary, in this case, could be John's Package Store, where you could go ahead and buy a couple of ounces of marijuana, as long as you can prove that you're 21 years old. Or that's what Schedule 3 is. That's what alcohol and cigarettes are. Schedule 4 means that you can get it without even having to worry about any kind of paperwork. I don't think it's going to get that far.
Maybe in one little place, if we're lucky. They might have like one dispensary in Connecticut somewhere.
I hear we have a medical marijuana dispensary already in the area, but I don't have the appropriate card to get there.
Yeah, I'm going to have to figure that out. Maybe go check that out one day.
Yeah, I've heard it's over where the old KFC in Winston used to be. You think so. But besides that, the problem right now is that because if it's a Schedule 4 or Schedule 1, Michele can't even if she gets a note from her medical doctor to go pick it up, she has to pay cash to buy an ounce of it. And she has no car. And that means that you cannot live in any kind of federalized housing because it's illegal in federalized housing. or any kind of federalized housing program. So which means I would have to give up my Section 8 anyway. Yeah. And that's another issue altogether. It has to do with RICO laws, which has to do with banking, is that these dispensaries that have been legally accepted within the different states, as just Washington, Oregon, and Colorado, cannot legally do any kind of loans, transactions with banks, or whatever, in credit, because of RICO laws. So what happens is they have to sometimes carry millions of dollars in cash in the back room. So they had to buy these huge honking safes to protect their assets. And then they got to pay the guards in cash. And they got to pay the staff in cash because they can't even pay them with checks. I still don't know how in the hell you're going to do the payroll. I don't know. It's a great question, though. How in the hell do dispensaries do the payroll if you can't even... How are you supposed to pay your checks to the government so you can't pay? Well, that was one of the things that they said, is that they may have to change the RICO laws because they are authorized by the states, Colorado, Washington, Oregon, Alaska, and, of course, Massachusetts. Is that they're going to have to change the banking laws, federal laws, so that those states which have legalized recreational as well as medicinal marijuana can legally have checking accounts for their dispensaries, so the dispensaries can write checks to prevent themselves from getting robbed blind by crooks. I'm going to be honest here. You got a couple $1 million sitting in a safe in the back room. It doesn't take too long to figure out that somebody's going to figure a way to get into your back room, break in your safe, and walk away with all your money.
Yep. It's done all the time.
Yeah, but when it happens to a convenience store, they don't have potentially millions of dollars sitting in a safe in the back room. They got maybe like a $2,000, $3,000 average. Exactly. Big difference. Way big difference. Well, what do you guys think? First of all, this is one of the strangest videos we've done. This is supposed to be my video, but this sort of ended up going into all kinds of weird tangents, and it never seems consistent between all the channel videos. And every time I ask my audience for suggestions for videos, I never get any. Yeah. So, Miss Audience, what topics do you want to discuss?
Please subscribe to Michelle's YouTube channel.
Actually, this is my channel. This is Lumi.
Lumi's.
Subscribe to my channel. YouTube. There's a little sign that says Lumi Finistra on the lower right-hand corner. Click on that, and you can subscribe to this channel directly. And that way you can... Michelle just shared this on her shares, and I share it on my shares. So, I'm sorry that this channel is kind of disorganized. It's stuff. It's been a long time since I've done a video. And, so, you know, if you guys got topics, let me know. You can send me emails or comment on this channel here. Email address is lumifinistra@gmail.com. That's lumifinistra@gmail.com. And let me know if you have ideas or suggestions. We'll try to cover them. New ones, new ideas. It's been a long time since I did a video. So if anything, this just tries to show you is that we're trying to keep doing videos, but we keep screwing up. Yeah, we keep screwing up, guys. Seriously.
Here, Fluffy Fluffy.
Excuse me?
I'm watching Fane.
Oh, watching the cat. As far as Michelle with your leg, I think that given the fact that you have been putting in a lot of extra time to try to get yourself mobile again, you said you were having dreams lately. I have been having dreams of 8 ounce Cumberland Farms extra sharp cheddar cheese blocks dancing in my head. What? I haven't had any sharp cheddar cheese in weeks. I so much want one so bad.
You'd get one for me too?
What's that?
You get one for me too?
I got a little bit of cash in my savings, but I don't really want to use my savings to get cheese.
I hear you.
Because Michelle only has like $3 in the checking account, so she wanted to save the money that was in her savings so that we could go ahead and do some things for next month. Mm. Right. But if you guys could make a donation to us somehow. You know, Lumi doesn't have any way of actually receiving donations at this point. No, because it gets kind of complicated when you don't even have a birth certificate on this earth. So I couldn't even open up a savings or checking account in my name. So we got to send the donations to Michelle. Yeah. And you could do that through a variety of ways. You could send it to michele3@yahoo.com through PayPal. You could send it to Patreon. That's www.patreon.com/michele. That's another way. The GoFundMe is almost the same, but it's kind of hard to keep it up. Yeah. And so as far as Michelle's leg goes, I think Michelle's leg is going to improve. I'm already seeing some improvement on it. And we've got a long ways to go before Michelle will be running anything really fast or anything. But she was able to pick up the pace this time going home. So give it some time to rebuild the muscle strength. And then, who knows, maybe in a couple of weeks she might be pretty much walking around town like nothing. Yeah, it would be good. That would be great. And you wanted to say anything right before we go?
Thank you very much.
No problem.
God bless you.
Yep.
God and Goddess bless.
Yep. Semper Fi.
Yeah.
Okay, guys. I gotta go. And see you guys later. Bye-bye. Bye-bye, everybody.